Screw it, why not?
Hi fellas, Leo's here. You know, when I think of what makes a console valuable, what should I go with, one or the other? Hell, why even consoles? Why not my cell phone or even... And yes, I see your point, I am irrelevant. But still, I grew up playing games, mostly the Super Nintendo and the PS1, and recently I started to collect all the consoles I can get my hands on, even the ones I even thought about, like a 360. And let me tell you, this is one classy bastard. It's got golf! And this is coming from someone who only knew about the OG Xbox because it can mod it and pack it with emulators. Oh, and Fable. So you can imagine my surprise when I learned that, yeah, the 360 has a lot of great games, and I'm glad I bit the bullet and got into it, so you can consider me a fan. But not a sucker. But overall, these are not your children. You gotta invest in them, spend a few months with them, and then decide you wanna keep it or not.
You gotta think, a good console doesn't depend on its age. Like, oh, only good consoles are the best, and it depends, really. Even I have to argue that recent consoles have shown a lot of passion and love into what developers do. Sure, it's easier to find stories of companies screwing up than it is find signs on a beach, but when a great game comes out, it becomes an event.
So what truly indicates that a console is great? Its games? Mostly, yeah.
After all, why get a console if you're not gonna like the games, and every console has their own objective market? Nintendo goes for the families and the young, Sony aims for young adults, focusing on stories with action set pieces, and Microsoft is just developing action games and buying companies. You can just go for the console developer that you grew up with, or you can just try new things. Except for Sega. Of course, every console has a preference for certain type of games. Personally, I started with platformers, then moved on to RPGs, and a few years ago I gave Halo a shot. Then I beat the Modern Warfare trilogy. Wait, hold up!
Oh! You're a good person.
But hey, it's not necessary to argue about the franchises that you enjoy. There's enough negativity on the internet as it is. No person will share the same answer about the games to choose. I mean, think about the Wii. Sure, it's mostly platformers and garbage, but still has RPGs, shooters, and the like. Personally, I went from the SNES to the PS1 because of the franchises that I love, like the Final Fantasy series, but also Symphony of the Night, Crash Team Racing, and Mega Man X4, so you can see how I could find similar tastes. Also, in Latin America, it's quite easy to sell the high seas, you know what I'm saying? And going for the N64 wouldn't have been a bad choice, but I would have thought about all those games I would have been missing otherwise. Now I look back on the console, I think about all the times that I enjoy playing Smash, GoldenEye, and Mario Kart 64 with my siblings and friends. So enjoyment is one of the biggest factors here, especially that time my cousin went to prison.
Ah yes, good old chance time.
Also, there's the topic of pricing. It's one big gamble to go for a console during the release date. We do get trailers for upcoming games, but most of them always come out like a year minimum, and it's not guaranteed that the quality of the games at the beginning will be the best. Before the HD era, your console would sell you back $250 brand new and pack it again, why not, so you can have fun while a good one comes out. And also a second controller to play with the siblings, that's it. You will most likely get a new game once or twice a year, so you better not break it or let it into your nasty ass cousin. If you go by that, it will be about $370. That's quite the investment to play just one game. That's why companies like Blockbuster are allowed to rent different games so you can try and see if maybe it was a good idea to spend $50 and buy them forever.
It's not.
I didn't get much of that kind of service growing up, but people always mention how it was magical trying new crazy games, see if maybe you could enjoy getting out of your comfort zone, and perhaps you could end up finding one of your favorite games. So it was only reasonable that a rental business would continue with the next generation consoles.
I should just stop hoping.
So, in the end, the pricing can be a big part of what console you end up choosing. Video games are getting more expensive to produce, and it's kind of difficult to pay $70 per game and also $1,000 for microtransactions, because God forbid they create a complete game. Personally, that's why I don't jump at the bandwagon and buy every game day one. All these games? Years after they came out. The one that was the least difference between the release and me purchasing it was Final Fantasy VII Remake. 2 years and for less than half the price. And this also applies for recent consoles. I bought 5 PS5 games with what I had to pay for 2 brand new ones, so you can just wait. It's not necessary to buy everything day one if it's out of your budget. Alright, listen, I'm a bitch. There's also the things that you can do with your console outside of the games, like playing online, listening to music, downloading demos, watching movies, build supercomputers, what? Change the day, there's so many options! Hide and seek? Sadly, that's what makes old consoles hard to go back to unless you get a good set of games for variety or maybe a game collection, or one of those multi-cards. But check before buying one of those, otherwise there goes your summer money. And then there's the collecting aspect. I mean, at that point, why even bother? I don't want to talk because I'm collecting consoles and games, but the idea is to actually play them. From time to time, I get nostalgic for some PS2 games, so I just pop it in and jam some Tenkaichi 3, but then there's that one guy, like, oh, I bought this 5-pound piece of shit, I'm not gonna play it, but hey, it's there. All I'm saying is, if you're gonna buy consoles, at least take them out of the box and enjoy them, otherwise you're just hoarding, and I'm still on the way there. And this applies mostly to the 7th generation on console onwards, but...
Can you tell I'm an ass guy?
Yeah, I need to grab something, not really a fan of digital versions. But hey, to each your own. You can have your things that you can hold, smell it, and appreciate it, maybe eat it. Or you can have a... nothing! Everyone wins! I know that's a whole topic by itself, but at least I'll say that having the choice of how you wish to build your collection gives it a good plus.
So what if you're not into... overcompensating? Well, I have a retro-compatible console for you!
Not that many, though. It's well known that having newer consoles playing games from earlier generation wasn't the biggest priority. The second consoles had it, and it was cool, but for the Super Nintendo, they just focused on getting the most out of the technology at the time. And I'd say that worked, and there's a reason why they basically made sequels to all the biggest franchises on the previous console, and even make remakes of the entire Mario series. And that's just fantastic, but it doesn't include the entire NES catalog. And you know who has always done a great job on that front? Xbox! Eventually. The entire line of consoles has worked on discs, so it was easier for them to adapt the newer generations to the previous less powerful technology, and they kept doing it till today. It didn't help sales though, but hey, at least you'll need to sell your old games. Or you can just buy the game 3 times at the same price, that's cool.
Also, one small thing to keep in mind, what about the status of the console? After all, there are some that gets recognized by its shape.
Sure, it has no effect on how the game runs or anything, but it gives a certain appeal, where people can just look at it and say,
oh yeah, that one! That one.
So we have multiple aspects to keep in mind, the price outside of gaming, not collecting, digital options, and the design. Out of all this, which one is the true judge, the one that indicates that a console is really valuable?
It's the games!
There's no contest, that's why there's only 3 major video game companies. That's how Nintendo beat Sega, Sony beat Sega, how everyone beat Sega. Oh my god, are you okay? In the long run, the advancement of technology, the innovation of game development, and pushing the console to the absolute limit, that's what truly defines a great console. Back when I was a kid, I had no idea that games like Donkey Kong Country were even possible, and I kept thinking that games wouldn't get any better than that. Now just look!
I know I never stop people from arguing about what console they prefer, or genres, or subgenres they think are better. It's not about forcing others to enjoy what you yourself do. We all have different tastes. I mean, well, someone wanna buy Batman Forever. I didn't, I swear, I was just coming back from school and it was there!